Are you ready to ace the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam? Then this comprehensive practice exam review series will help you do just that. Join us as we deep dive into the world of cloud computing and AWS and unlock the secrets to passing the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam with ease. Now, if you haven't already, ensure you've checked out the full AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner training course here on the Cloud Vikings channel to quickly get up to speed on all the exam topic areas. Now, that course was originally a paid course hosted on a learning management platform and included a ton of quizzes and other supplementary resources and some other videos that covered some AWS services that may be in scope for the AWS CCP exam that just wouldn't port over well to this YouTube video format. Now, I think the most important area that's missing is that I had a number of practice exam simulators in that original course that simply wouldn't work through YouTube. Now, as a way to fill in any missing exam topic coverage areas, and address a number of asks in our comments and in the Discord channel around any additional study material and resources for practice exams, I figured I'd actually do some videos covering mock practice exam questions, similar to what you'd see in the real exam. Then I'll walk through each of these questions to help understand what the correct answer is, and almost more importantly, that you understand why the wrong ones are incorrect. So this will be a great follow-up review for students to supplement the full training course video and ensure you have a full, complete coverage of all the exam topics and reinforce what you've learned and identify any areas that may need additional review. Now, to make sure these practice exam walkthrough videos are of high value to those about to take the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam, I actually just did a retake of the exam myself last night, just to ensure that I had an up-to-date look at the exam questions so I could create some practice questions based on what I experienced in my exam. Now, I won't be putting any real exam questions here as there's simply no value in doing that for students truly trying to learn cloud computing and AWS. And it's, of course, against the AWS terms and conditions to share real exam questions. But I've tried to create questions and responses here that get to the same end goal of understanding these exam topic areas and simulate the question format and wording you can expect to see. So having gone through this review, you'll feel a lot more relaxed when taking the actual exam, as you already have an idea of what to expect. Now, if you haven't already, please subscribe to the channel and hit that notification bell to ensure you're getting notified about future tips and training content for your cloud and DevOps exams, along with other great tutorials and informative videos covering cloud and DevOps topics to help you learn and unleash your full potential in the cloud. Now, this video is intended for review and reinforcement of the exam topics, and it isn't meant to be a standalone full course by itself. So be sure to check out the full AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner Exam training course here on the channel first if you haven't already, or that you've at least done some form of study for the AWS CCP exam topics. And then when you've gone through that course, you'll be ready to progress through this video doing the review of the practice questions. Now, I figured I'd approach these practice exam review questions in a few stages as a way to help you identify any areas that you have any knowledge gaps or need to know more about a certain AWS service. First, I'll present the question with none of the multiple choice responses. At this first stage, it'll be the ultimate test of your understanding. If you can answer the question without seeing any of the possible answers, it should be a good indication that you have enough understanding of that topic to confidently answer it correctly. For each question at this first stage, even if you're not sure, I'd suggest writing down what you think the answer would be. As the question is presented, pause the video before the answers come up and write down what you think the correct answer is. Then at this point, unpause the video again and reveal the correct answer and my breakdown of all the multiple choice options. If you got the question wrong, amazing. Just make notes of that question topic area and what the source of your confusion was, and just dive a bit deeper into that service or topic as part of your review, and you'll nail it next time. And even more important, you'll have a deeper understanding of that type of question should it come up again on the real exam. Now, I'll include the practice exam questions in the video description chapter index so you can jump around in the video to find the ones you may have gotten wrong the first time doing the review. Now, there's a character limit in that video description field, so I'll do my best to include all the chapter reference points that I can fit in there. All right, so for our first practice exam question here, let's slowly walk through it as an example of what I was just talking about. And then after that, if you like that format of pausing the video and doing the review, that's great. You can continue on. Or continue on with the rest of the questions in a way that works for you. So the first question, which AWS service provides a highly scalable, fully managed database? Now, this is the point where you should pause the video and try to see if you can come up with the answer just on your own. And then when you've written the answer down, unpause the video to reveal the possible answers. Now, as you look at the possible answer options here, if any of the AWS services or answers doesn't really make sense, pause the video again and go look at the AWS documentation to become familiar with that AWS service. So that's going to be a really important part of these practice exam review questions, that you don't just focus on this particular question and the right answer, that you look at all the possible options here and review each of the AWS services that come up if you're not familiar with it. So potentially within one single practice exam question here, you have the opportunity to review five possible AWS services or possible answers. Now for some of the questions, I may have made up an AWS service that doesn't actually exist, and it's just to throw you off and ensure that you're going out to the AWS documentation and researching anything that you're not familiar with. So going back to our question here of which AWS service provides a highly scalable, fully managed database. If we look at the options, a good strategy is to often rule out any answers that you know right away are incorrect. So for example, Amazon S3, we should know that that's a object storage service. The question here is asking about a highly scalable, fully managed database, so that doesn't seem like a great fit, so we could potentially rule that one out right away. Now, on the other hand, the answer may jump out at you right away. You might be familiar with what the question's asking and familiar with all the possible answers. I'd still suggest to keep your answer in your mind and quickly review the other possible answers. Sometimes there's more than one right answer that can solve the solution or address the scenario, but there's sort of a better answer. So just be sure to skim through all the possible options before making your final choice. So which AWS service provides a highly scalable, fully managed database in this case? We want to pick the Amazon Relational Database Service, or RDS. So the answer would be D. So from here on in, we're going to fly through the questions quite a bit quicker. So just be ready with that pause button if you want to take that sort of progressive approach to going through the questions and coming up with your own answers and reviewing the possible options and that type of thing. All right, so on to question number two. What is the primary purpose of the Amazon Elastic Compute Cloud, EC2? We have A, storing and retrieving data, B, identifying security threats, C, managing virtual networks, D, providing highly scalable compute resources, or E, managing database instances. The answer here would be D, providing highly scalable compute resources. So for number three, what is the maximum file size for an object stored in Amazon S3? We have A, 1 GB, B, 5 GB, C, 10 GB, D, 100 GB, or E, 5 TB. And the correct answer here would be E, 5 TB. And then number four, what is the purpose of AWS Identity and Access Management, IAM? Is it A, managing virtual machines, B, monitoring application performance, C, scaling database instances, D, controlling access to AWS resources, or E, managing DNS records? And the correct answer here would be D, controlling access to AWS resources. And number five, which AWS service can be used to distribute content globally and accelerate website performance? Is it A, Amazon CloudFront, B, Amazon Route 53, C, Amazon S3, D, AWS Elastic Beanstalk, or E, AWS Lambda? And here the correct answer would be A, Amazon CloudFront. All right, moving on to question six. What does the AWS Lambda service provide? Is it A, object storage, B, database management, C, compute resources, D, serverless function execution, or E, DNS management? And here the correct answer would be D, serverless function execution. Now, as you're going through all these questions, if you perhaps disagree with my answer for a given question or want some help in terms of understanding why that answer was chosen versus some of the others, add those questions and comments into the comments of the video here, and we'll get a bit of a discussion going around why that answer was chosen, or I'll try my best to help everyone out with their questions as well. All right, moving on to question 7. What is the purpose of Amazon CloudFront? Is it A, content delivery and acceleration, B, database storage and retrieval, C, DNS management, D, load balancing traffic, or E, DNS management? And the correct answer here would be A, content delivery and acceleration. All right, so moving on to question 8. What does AWS Elastic Beanstalk provide? Is it A, object storage, B, compute resources, C, serverless function execution, D, managed platform for application deployment, E, DNS management? The correct answer here would be D, managed platform for application deployment. And number 9, what can be used to generate a report of all the IAM users and their MFA device status with the least amount of effort? Is it A, create a custom script using the AWS CLI to query the IAM service and export the result? B, Amazon Macy? C, Amazon GuardDuty? D, download an IAM credential report through the IAM service? Or E, Trusted Advisor security checks? The correct answer here would be D, download an IAM credential report through the IAM service. And question 10, what is the purpose of Amazon RDS? A, object storage, B, disaster recovery, C, real-time data sync, D, a managed relational database service, or E, reliable content delivery and acceleration? A managed relational database service. And question 11. Which AWS service can be used to automatically scale resources based on application load? Is it A, Amazon CloudWatch, B, AWS Elastic Beanstalk, C, Amazon S3, D, Amazon GuardDuty, or E, Amazon EC2 Autoscaling? E, Amazon EC2 Autoscaling. And question 12, what is the purpose of AWS CloudFormation? Managing virtual networks, B, database management, C, infrastructure as code or IAC, D, object storage organization, or E, DNS management? Infrastructure as code. 13. Which pillar of the AWS well-architected framework refers to the ability of a system to recover from various failures and automatically scale resources to meet demand? Is it A, cost optimization, B, security, C, reliability, D, performance efficiency, or E, sustainability? Reliability. 14. Which component of the AWS global infrastructure is made up of one or more discrete data centers that have redundant power, networking, and connectivity? Is it A, AWS region, B, AWS outposts, C, edge locations, or D, availability zones, or E, global backbone network? Availability zones. 15. Which AWS service is used to send and receive messages between distributed systems? Is it A, Amazon S3, B, Amazon SQS, C, Amazon RDS, D, AWS Lambda, or E, Amazon EC2? E, Amazon SQS. 16. What is the purpose of Amazon Simple Notification Service, or SNS? Is it A, resource monitoring, B, messaging service for distributing notifications, C, billing alerts, D, managed email, or E, AWS service interruption alerts? E, a messaging service for distributing notifications. 17. What AWS service or feature acts as a firewall for Amazon EC2 instances? Is it A, network ACLs, B, Amazon Virtual Private Cloud, C, Elastic Network Interface, D, AWS WAF, or E, security groups? E, security groups. 18. What AWS service or feature can help protect applications running on AWS from DDoS attacks? Is it A, AWS Web Application Firewall or WAF, B, Amazon Shield, C, Amazon Inspector, D, Amazon Guard Duty, or E, security groups? E, Amazon Shield. 19. A company wants to find out if a security group configuration was changed and by who. What two AWS services could be used to determine this? A, AWS Inspector, B, AWS Config, C, Amazon CloudWatch, D, AWS IAM, or E, AWS CloudTrail. So for this one, we need to choose two possible answers. E, B, AWS Config, and E, AWS CloudTrail. Question 20. Which AWS service uses machine learning to help discover sensitive data that is stored in Amazon S3 buckets? Is it A, AWS Shield, B, AWS Network Firewall, C, Amazon MACI, D, AWS IAM, or E, Amazon GuardDuty? The correct answer would be C, Amazon MACI. And 21. A company runs its workloads on-premises. The company wants to forecast the cost of running a large application on AWS. Which AWS service or tool can help obtain this information? Is it A, Cost Explorer, B, AWS Pricing Calculator, C, Amazon MACI, D, AWS Application Migration Service, or E, AWS Trusted Advisor? The correct answer here would be B, the AWS Pricing Calculator. Which AWS feature or service can help enable network traffic filtering at the subnet level? Is it A, Internet Gateway, B, Security Groups, C, Amazon Inspector, D, AWS WAF, E, Network Access Control List? B, E, Network Access Control List, or NACLs. 23. What AWS tool or service allows users to access and download compliance reports about the AWS infrastructure? A, AWS Artifact, B, Amazon Security Hub, C, AWS Systems Manager, D, AWS Config, or E, AWS IAM Access Analyzer. AWS Artifact. 24. A customer is trying to determine responsibility for patching the host operating system of an EC2 instance. Based on the AWS Shared Responsibility Model, who is responsible? Is it A, AWS? B, the operating system software vendor? C, the customer? D, both the customer and AWS? Or E, EC2 instances are a managed service and patching is not necessary? The customer. Question 25. Which of the AWS global infrastructure benefits is related to an architecture's ability to withstand failures with minimal downtime? Is it A, security, B, availability, C, performance, D, scalability, or E, flexibility? E, availability. Question 26. Which AWS service helps monitor AWS accounts for potential security threats? Is it A, AWS Inspector, B, AWS Secrets Manager, C, Amazon Cognito, D, AWS GuardDuty, or E, AWS Shield? D, AWS GuardDuty. 27. Which AWS service or feature can be used to send both text and email messages between distributed applications? Is it A, Amazon SES, B, Amazon Message Hub, C, Amazon EventBridge, D, Amazon SQS, or E, Amazon SNS? Amazon SNS. 28. A customer urgently requires a non-relational database on AWS. They have small technical teams and do not want to maintain the database instances or the database software aspects. Which AWS service would be the best fit for them? A, Amazon Aurora. B, self-managed open source database on EC2. C, Amazon DynamoDB. D, Amazon RDS. Or E, AWS Elastic Beanstalk. The best answer here would be C, Amazon DynamoDB. 29. A mobile gaming company needs to implement identity management for mobile apps launching soon that operate on the AWS cloud. Which AWS service would help them implement this with the least effort? Is it A, AWS Lambda, B, AWS Cognito, C, AWS IAM, D, Amazon CloudFront, or E, AWS Security Hub? It would be B, AWS Cognito. 30. Which AWS service can a company leverage to manage Docker images created by their development teams? Is it A, Amazon EFS, B, Amazon Kinesis, C, Amazon S3, D, Amazon ECR, or E, AWS Docker Hub? Amazon ECR. And question 31. An organization is interested in the full set of AWS Trusted Advisor checks, but has limited budget for AWS support costs. What is the least expensive support plan to achieve this? Is it A, AWS Basic Support, B, AWS Developer Support, C, AWS Business Support, D, Enterprise On-Ramp Support, or E, Enterprise Support? The correct AWS Business Support. 32. What would be a core benefit of application decoupling when used as an AWS cloud architecture design? A. Lower costs. B. Increased agility by enabling individual components to be updated without impacting others. C. Reduction of infrastructure scaling requirements. D. Shift of responsibility from the customer to AWS for maintaining the application code. Or E. Lower latency. 3. Increased agility by enabling individual components to be updated without impacting others. Question 33. An educational facility receives course enrollment applications through handwritten paper forms in PDF format. They want to reduce the manual and error-prone process of entering the data on these forms into their database. Which AWS service can help automate this process? Is it A, Amazon Comprehend, B, Amazon Transcribe, C, Amazon Textract, D, Amazon SageMaker, or E, Amazon Recognition? D, Amazon Textract. Question 34. Which of the following falls under the responsibility of AWS based on the shared responsibility model? Is it A, OS patches on EC2 instances, B, updates to customer application code running on AWS Lambda, C, maintaining the network equipment within an AZ, D, configuring security groups, or E, performing cost optimizations for resources within a VPC? C, maintaining the networking equipment within an AZ. 35. Which of the following best represents AWS local zones? Is it A, they support reducing latency for end users by enabling a limited number of compute and storage services locally to users? B, AWS Direct Connect connection location? C, new AWS regions which are not connected to AWS Global Backbone Network yet? D, large number of data center facilities geographically within a 100-kilometer or 60-mile radius? Or E, a geographic site facility used by Amazon CloudFront for caching frequently accessed content? They support reducing latency for end users by enabling a limited number of compute and storage services locally to users. 36. Which of the following are within the AWS compute category of services? Choose two. AWS Batch, B, AWS CloudFormation, C, Amazon SageMaker, D, Amazon RDS, or E, Amazon LightSail? Are A, AWS Batch, and E, Amazon LightSail? 37. A company operates in a heavily regulated area that has many compliance considerations for their IT infrastructure. What could the company use to generate documentation to help determine if using the AWS public cloud meets their compliance requirements? Is it A, open an AWS support case requesting the necessary AWS compliance data, B, export a full compliance report through AWS GuardDuty, C, download the necessary documents through AWS Artifact, D, review the CloudTrail log files stored in S3, or E, download the necessary documents through AWS Security Hub? The correct answer here would be C. Download the necessary documents through AWS Artifact. 38. A development team is working on a large application code refactoring project, and they're looking for a service that can securely host GitHub-based code, repositories, and support version controls. Which AWS service should the development team consider? A. AWS X-Ray. B. AWS Code Pipeline. C. AWS Code Commit. D. AWS Code Deploy. Or E. Amazon Code Guru. Answer here be C. AWS Code Commit. 39. What best defines an AWS region? A. A physical location around the world where AWS clusters its data centers and has a minimum of 3 availability zones. B. It reduces latency by delivering data through over 450 globally dispersed points of presence with automated network mapping and intelligent routing. C. One or more discrete data centers with redundant power, networking, and connectivity. D. Native AWS services, infrastructure, and operating models within virtually any data center, colocation space, or on-premises facility. Or E, general-purpose serverless compute feature that supports a wide range of computing needs and customizations, allowing code to be run closer to users of the application. 40. A physical location around the world where AWS clusters data centers and has a minimum of 3 availability zones within it. And question 40. Which of the following are not a capability of the AWS Cloud Adoption Framework, or CAF? A. People. B. Governance. C. Platform. D. Agility. Or E. Operations. Agility. 41. An organization wants to launch a containerized application, and you're looking for a container orchestration service to automatically provision and manage the backend instances and scale the application containers as needed. Which AWS service could meet these requirements? Would it be A, Amazon Lightsail, B, Amazon EC2, C, AWS Elastic Container Registry, D, Amazon EKS, or E, AWS Compute Optimizer? The best answer here would be D, Amazon EKS. 40. Which two actions require the AWS account root user to perform them? Is it A, disabling the AWS IAM service from the account, B, closing the AWS account, C, enabling the Amazon SageMaker service, D, viewing cost and usage data, or E, making changes to the AWS support plan? So the two answers here would be B, closing the AWS account, and E, making changes to the AWS support plan. 43. A company just launched a successful marketing campaign, and it has resulted in a large increase in traffic to their backend EC2 instances running the website. They're looking to horizontally scale by adding more EC2 instances, but need to balance the incoming HTTP traffic across them. What is the best choice? Is it A, use a gateway load balancer, B, network load balancer, C, Amazon CloudFront, D, application load balancer, or E, Amazon EventBridge? The correct answer here would be D, application load balancer. 44. Which pillar of the AWS Well Architected Framework covers the continuous improvement of processes and procedures? Is it A, sustainability, B, reliability, C, cost optimization, D, performance efficiency, or E, operational excellence? The correct answer here is E, operational excellence. 45. A company is operating in a hybrid cloud model Using AWS S3 to storage large amounts of data that is generated from their on-premises analytics systems. Some of this data is accessed frequently by on-premises systems and requires low latency access. What AWS service could help support this low latency hybrid cloud storage workflow? Would it be A, the AWS Storage Gateway, B, AWS DMS, C, Amazon FSx, D, Amazon EBS, or E, Amazon Snowball? The best answer here would be A, AWS Storage Gateway. A new company launched their website and is targeted at a global audience. The website consists of static content that will not change often. What AWS service should be considered to decrease the latency experience by their global end users with the least amount of effort? Would it be A, to use the AWS Network Load Balancer, B, AWS Lambda, C, AWS WAF, D, Amazon CloudFront, or E, Amazon CloudFormation? The best answer here would be E, Amazon CloudFront. Question 47. Which AWS service could help proactively alert operations teams about AWS service interruption events that may impact AWS resources a company uses? Is it A, AWS Trusted Advisor, B, AWS Service Health Dashboard, C, AWS Personal Health Dashboard, D, Amazon Connect, or E, AWS Cloud 9? The best answer here would be C, AWS Personal Health Dashboard. Question 48. Which of the following are design principles of the reliability pillar of the AWS Well-Architected Framework? Choose three. Is it stop guessing capacity? B, learn from all operational failures? C, ensure workloads operate within a single availability zone? D, automatically recover from failure? Or E, manage change through automation? The three answers here would be A, stop guessing capacity, D, automatically recover from failure, and E, manage change through automation. Question 49. Which AWS service offers an in-memory data store? Is it A, Amazon DynamoDB, B, Amazon Neptune, C, Amazon Redshift, D, Amazon ElastiCache, E, Amazon EBS? The answer here is D, Amazon ElastiCache. And question 50. A company wants to reliably archive a large number of video files that are between 50 megabytes and 5 gigabytes into Amazon S3. They expect to only access the files no more than once a year, but when they do, they need the files to be available right away. What would be the lowest cost S3 storage class that meets these needs? Would it be Amazon S3 Standard, B, S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval, C, S3 Intelligent Tiering, D, S3 Glacier Deep Archive, or E, S3 Standard Infrequently Accessed? The lowest cost option here would be B, S3 Glacier Instant Retrieval. Which AWS service could enable a serverless workflow? Would it be A, AWS Lambda, B, AWS Fargate, C, AWS Step Functions, D, AWS App Mesh, or E, Amazon Connect? To support a serverless workflow, the best answer here would be C, AWS Step Functions. 52. A company has strict compliance restrictions and need to operate all their infrastructure within their own data center facility. The company would like to use Amazon EC2, Amazon S3, and Amazon RDS for some new projects. What is the recommended approach? deploy an AWS Outpost rack within their data center. B, configure AWS Direct Connect for a dedicated network connection between the data center and an AWS VPC to connect to these AWS services. C, ignore the compliance requirements, since AWS has many industry compliance certifications, and compliance needs will be met by default just by using AWS. D, expand the capacity of the data center for the new projects, since these services are only available external to their data center on the AWS public cloud. Or E, deploy an AWS private link rack within their data center. The best approach here would be A, deploy an AWS Outpost rack within their data center. Question 53. A large enterprise company has multiple engineering and development teams. The company is looking to charge each team for its specific AWS cloud usage, including data transfer costs. What AWS service or feature can they use to accomplish this? Would it be A, to use AWS organizations for automated cost allocation through built-in machine learning capabilities? B, use AWS Cost Explorer? C, review the monthly AWS invoice charges in the AWS billing console? D, create a new AWS account for each team to isolate costs? Or E, to use cost allocation tags on the resources used by each team, where the tag represents each unique development team to easily isolate costs? The best answer here would be E, to use cost allocation tags on the resources used by each team. 54. A company has just completed an acquisition of another company, both of which have multiple AWS accounts. The newly merged accounting team would like to simplify the AWS invoices and have all the AWS account charges aggregated together. What would accomplish this with the minimal effort? Would it be A, to modify each account's payment method to the same credit card? B, use AWS organizations? C, link the AWS accounts through Cost Explorer? D, open a support case each month with the AWS Concierge team to generate a custom invoice with the combined cost and usage? Or E, plan a migration of AWS resources from the acquired company accounts into the existing ones, and then use the AWS root user to close the leftover accounts. To use AWS organizations. Question 55. An organization requires a large EC2 compute resource for a one-year research contract. The application workload will need to be very stable and consistent over that one-year period. They need to avoid any large upfront costs. What would you recommend as the most cost-effective EC2 purchasing option given these requirements? Would it be A, to use EC2 instant savings plans, a three-year term, no upfront? B, compute savings plan, one-year term, all upfront? C, on-demand instances? D, reserved instances, one-year, all upfront? Or E, compute savings plan, one-year term, no upfront? That have three-year terms or all upfront pricing, the leftover most cost-effective EC2 purchasing option would be E, the compute savings plan with a one-year term, no upfront option. 56. An e-commerce company needs to manage multiple TLS certificates. It has become a challenge to provision and deploy these certificates for the operations team. What AWS service would you recommend to simplify the certificate management task? Would it be A, AWS Secrets Manager? B, AWS Certificate Manager? C, AWS Shield? D, Amazon S3? Or E, Amazon Cognito? The answer here would be B, AWS Certificate Manager. 57. What AWS service would help a security team audit all the API activity occurring within an AWS account? Would it be A, AWS CloudWatch, B, AWS Shield, C, AWS CloudTrail, D, Amazon Athena, or E, Amazon TrailWatch? The answer here would be C, AWS CloudTrail. What is the purpose of an Amazon Virtual Private Cloud, or VPC? Is it A, to secure object storage, B, provide compute resources, C, serverless function execution, D, networking and isolation of resources, or E, database management? The correct answer here would be D, networking and isolation of resources. Question 59. Which free resources are available from AWS to ask questions to both AWS employees and AWS customer community members, and ask questions through live QA sessions? Choose two. A, AWS Repost. B, AWS Enterprise Support Plan. C, AWS Online Tech Talks. D, AWS Business Support Plan. Or E, Amazon CloudTrail. AWS Repost, and C, AWS Online Tech Talks. Question 60. A company wants to offer customer support through phone and chat. The company needs a solution that remote customer service staff can use to manage these customer support interactions. What AWS service could the company consider? Could they use A, AWS Support Plans, B, Amazon Cognito, C, AWS Direct Connect, D, Amazon Connect, or E, Amazon Textract? The answer here would be D, Amazon Connect. What is the purpose of AWS Direct Connect? Is it A, to support serverless workflow orchestration, B, a private link between two or more AWS services within a VPC, C, a dedicated network connection to AWS, D, connection to AWS for IoT devices, or E, a designated technical account manager assigned to your AWS account? The correct answer here would be C, a dedicated network connection to AWS. 62. A development team has stopped all their EC2 instances since the project they are working on is complete. They don't expect to use the instances again for a few weeks. The team manager received the AWS invoice and noticed there are still monthly EC2 related charges occurring. Why is this? Choose two. Is it A, data transfer costs, B, Elastic IP costs, C, is it A, data transfer costs, B, Elastic IP costs, C, AMI costs, D, Amazon EBS storage costs, or E, EC2 on-demand usage costs? It would be B, Elastic IP costs, and D, Amazon EBS storage costs. 63. Horizontally scaled web hosts need access to the same shared files. Which AWS service could help with this? Would it be A, Amazon Redshift, B, AWS Snowcone, C, Amazon CloudFront, D, Amazon RDS, or E, Amazon EFS? The correct answer here would be E, Amazon EFS. 64. Which of the following AWS services performs automated backups of data by default? Is it A, Amazon Aurora, B, Amazon EFS, C, AWS CloudTrail, D, Amazon Recognition, E, Amazon S3? Amazon Aurora. 65. Which AWS service monitors the CPU load metrics for EC2 instances? Would it be A, Amazon CloudWatch, B, Amazon GuardDuty, C, AWS CloudTrail, D, AWS Config, or E, Amazon Inspector? The correct answer here would be A, Amazon CloudWatch.